to the English Department's first annual Hopkins Lecture. This is a series that will focus on contemporary writing with speakers drawn from either or both of our two disciplines, English literature and English language. The series is named for the poet Gerard Manley Hopkins, who lived and worked at the site of our creative campus. Hopkins is one eminent example of the literary and linguistic life of our city. The Hopkins lectures will complement the excellent, world-leading research of our department. We hope that they will also be a significant event in the university's calendar and for Liverpool as a whole. We would like to express our appreciation to our Vice Chancellor, Professor Gerald Pillay, for his support in establishing these Hopkins lectures. It would be hard to find a more appropriate writer to present the first Hopkins lecture than the novelist, essayist, and thinker Marilynne Robinson. She is the author of the acclaimed and award-winning novels Housekeeping, Gilead, Home, and Lila, of nonfiction polemics such as Mother Country and The Death of Adam, and of a host of essays and commentaries. Her concern with God's transcendence, her use of complex metaphors, and her sense of cultural declension make it unsurprising that critics compare her concerns with those of Gerard Manley Hopkins. Nevertheless, it is important to recognize Marilynne Robinson as a quintessentially American writer, a writer steeped in and absolutely at home with the American literary tradition, a tradition from which she has clearly derived inspiration and within which she is herself in conversation with a number of illustrious predecessors, including Ralph Waldo Emerson, Henry David Thoreau, Herman Melville, Walt Whitman, Emily Dickinson, and Edgar Allan Poe. In interviews, references to these American writers reveal the depth of this kinship. Indeed, Marilynne Robinson's speculations about the work of these writers of the American Renaissance holds up the mirror to her own work. In one interview, Robinson refers to a characteristic pattern within American literature wherein an individual undertakes a journey through experience that becomes a journey into consciousness, a journey from which there is no way back. She cites Moby Dick as a prime example. Such works of art, she argues, are based on, and I'm quoting, the assumption that the only way to understand the world is metaphorical and that all metaphors are inadequate. Robinson's sense of the emblematic nature of language comes from biblical parables, from the Puritans' plain style, from Emerson's ideas about language. These are part of the same tradition, as Robinson points out, a tradition that demanded active intellectual engagement, required that the individual take responsibility for his or her beliefs, and articulated these with logic and with clarity. Tonight, Marilynne Robinson has chosen to speak to us on the subject of what are we doing here? Her talk is a response to Alexis de Tocqueville's contention in Democracy in America that literature is, and I'm quoting, an arsenal open to all, where the weak and the poor could always find arms. Tocqueville's book, translated into English in 1835 and 1840, attempted to place American experience within the wider sweep of history. In doing so, he interrogated the implications and significance of his experience of the United States as reconceptualized within his own imagination. It is with a sense of privilege and great anticipation that I introduce Marilynne Robinson's lecture here tonight on What Are We Doing Here?
It's a great pleasure to be here, an honor. It's such a lovely, vibrant campus you have here. It has been very impressive, pleasing to see all the good work that's being done. I love universities, and this university is a very worthy object of my love. I've definitely added it to my list. I'm going to talk tonight about how the universities of North America, as you call it, that invented country, and Britain are being dealt with and thought of in the contemporary moment. I would call it political, I think, more than any other word. There's a similarity that I think means that we have a conversation that ought to be going on your side of the Atlantic and on ours about what the universities are and what we want from them and what we need to protect in them. I should explain perhaps that in America, you know, we have 4 years of college. The first 2 years are typically spent on what are called requirements, which tend to be humanities courses, language, literature, psychology, perhaps, history, and so on. These are preparations for the specialization that will occur in the second 2 years of college. When people major actually in the liberal arts, when they spend 4 years and get a bachelor's degree in literature or whatever, this is considered an entirely appropriate preparation for many kinds of professional training beyond that. So in other words, we center our education around the humanities, essentially, and then specialization within them or beyond them is something that comes later in education. So I've been reading lately about the rise of humanism in Europe and Britain in the 15th century. The old scholars often describe themselves as ravished by one of the books newly made available to them by the press, perhaps also by translation. Their lives were usually short, never comfortable. I think what it would have been like to read by the light of an oil lamp, to write with a goose quill. It used to seem to me that an unimaginable self-discipline must account for their meticulous learnedness. I assumed that the rigors and austerities of their early training had made their discomforts too familiar to be noticed. Now, increasingly, I think they were held to their work by a degree of fascination, of sober delight, that we can hardly imagine. John Milton said, "As well kill a man as kill a good book." He was arguing unsuccessfully against licensing, the suppression or censoring of books before publication. This was usual in the pre-modern and early modern world, of course, and is not uncommon now. How many good books were killed outright by these means, we will never know. Even granting the labors of printers who defied the threat of hair-raising punishments to publish unlicensed work, and which others risked hair-raising penalties to own or to read. To put books into English, the vulgar tongue, the language of the masses, was once radical. Teaching literature written in English is a recent innovation, historically speaking, and was long regarded in the more renowned institutions as a lowering of standards. It is still the case in some countries that the work of living writers is excluded from the curriculum. Perhaps a sign of lingering prejudice against the vernacular, against what people say and think now in the always disparaged present. In America, this scruple is gone and forgotten. Writers not yet dead, in many cases only emerging, are read and pondered, usually under a rubric of some kind that makes them representative of gender or ethnicity or region, Therefore, instances of some perspective or trend often of greater interest to the professor than to any of the writers. These categories, women or black or immigrant, can be encumbrances from the writer's point of view, obstacles to the reading of their work as something more than sociological data. If there are courses explicitly attentive to white men as a subgroup, I've never heard of any. Male and white is still the default where literature is concerned, in the academy at least. This is not the fault of any of these men, and they should not be undervalued or misread on this account. But knowing what a book costs any writer, in years not least, I hope for the day when all good books can be read as speaking in as broad a voice, also engaged with the great questions. However, I am too aware of the ragged beast history has been to fret over the fact that its manners are not perfect yet. I think it is most excellent that so many voices are being heard, and that the ongoing life of this endless human work creating literature is acknowledged in real time. This has supported the teaching of writing that is so widespread in American universities. These same living writers come into the universities to lecture and teach as the great literary figures whose writing is consecrated by time could not do even if they wished. This is in effect a system of patronage that leaves no one beholden and that makes thousands of students aware that writers are not so unlike themselves, a valuable stimulus to aspiration. The old energies are still at work. All this works rather well. It has given me an interesting life, allowing me all the time a novel requires and every resource for following out the questions that arise as I work. I have enjoyed the company of young writers and I've learned from them. I know that one is expected to bemoan the present time, to say something about decline and the loss of values, but I find a great deal to respect. That said, it is a familiar irony that prohibition and deprivation can make things potent and ravishing, and that plenty very often dulls our taste for them. There is a great deal of questioning now of the value of the humanities, those aptly named disciplines that make us wonder what human beings have been and are and will be. Sometimes I think they should be renamed big data. These catastrophic wars that afflict so much of the world now surely bear more resemblance to the Hundred Years' War or the 30 Years' War or the wars of Napoleon or the First World War than they do to any expectations we have had about how history would unfold in the modern period, otherwise known as those few decades we call the post-war. We have thought we were being cynical when we insisted that people universally are motivated by self-interest. Would God it were true. Hamlet's rumination on the 20,000 men going off to fight over a territory not large enough for them all to be buried in, going to their graves as if to their beds, shows a much sounder grasp of human behavior than this. It acknowledges a part of it that shows how absurdly optimistic our cynicism actually is. President Obama recently set off a kerfuffle among the press, who should and no doubt do know better, by saying that these firestorms of large-scale violence and destruction are not unique to Islamic culture or to the present time. This is simple fact, and it is also fair warning, if we hope to keep our own actions and reactions within something like civilized bounds. And here's another, this would be one use of history. And here's another. We might stop persuading ourselves of the truth of notions that are flatly implausible in light of all we know, or could know if we cared to. Then we would be less confident in imposing our assumptions on behavior, including our own, that they cannot help us interpret. The aversion to history shelters some very important errors and sometimes does so aggressively. A society is moving toward dangerous ground when loyalty to the truth is seen as disloyalty to some supposedly higher interest. How many times has history taught us this? In the context of contemporary politics, someone who has a certain awareness of history, the president, for example, is expected to speak as if he did not. He is expected to have mastery of an artificial language, a language made up arbitrarily of the terms and references of a non-existent world, which is conjured out of prejudice and nostalgia and mis- and disinformation, as well as fashion and slovenliness among the opinion makers. Any dialect becomes second nature to those who live among its speakers, and this one is pervasive in ordinary educated life. Anyone who has wandered now and then into the vast arcana of what we have been and done and carried some learning away with her or him is prone to violating the dialect's strict and narrow usage and will be corrected. I'm not speaking here of the obvious malefactors, the blowhards on the radio and on television. I'm speaking of the mainstream media. Therefore, though I hate to say it, of the institutions that educate most people of influence in America, including journalists. Our great universities, with their vast resources, their exhaustive libraries, look like a humanist's dream. Certainly, with the collecting and archiving that has taken place in them over centuries, they could tell us much that we need to know. But there is pressure on the universities now to change fundamentally, to equip our young to be what the Fabians used to call brain workers. They are to be skilled labor in the new economy, intellectually nimble enough to meet its needs, which we know will change constantly and unpredictably. I may simply have described the robots that will be better suited to this kind of existence, and with whom our optimized workers will no doubt be forced to compete, poor, complex, and distractible creatures that they will be still. Why teach the humanities? Why study them? American universities are literally shaped around them and have been since their founding. Yet the question is put in the bluntest form, what are they good for? If, for purposes of discussion, we date the beginning of the humanist movement to 1500, then historically speaking, the West has flourished materially as well as culturally in the period of their influence. You may have noticed that the United States always considers itself to be in an existential struggle with an imagined competitor. It may have been the Cold War that instilled this habit in us. It may have been the 19th century nationalism, when America was coming of age and competition among the great powers of Europe drove world events. Whatever etiology is proposed for it, whatever excuse is made for it, however rhetorically useful it may be in certain contexts, the habit is deeply harmful, as it has been in Europe as well, when the competition involved the claiming and defending of colonies, as well as militarization that led to appalling war, and it is dangerous in Europe now. The consequences of these things abide. We see and feel them every day. Competition is worse than absurd because the standards that might seem to make societies commensurable are essentially meaningless except when they are ominous. Insofar as we treat them as real, we mean that other considerations are put out of account. Who died in all those wars? The numbers lost assure us that there were artists and poets and mathematicians among them and statesmen, though at best their circumstances may never have allowed them or us to realize their gifts. What was lost to those colonizations? The many regions of the world that bore the brunt of them struggle to discover a social order they can accept as legitimate and authoritative, with major consequences for the old colonizers and the whole world. Who loses in these economic competitions? Those who win, first of all, because the foot soldiers of those economies work too much for meager, even uncertain pay, and are exposed to insult this cheapening of fundamental value, visits on the earth and the air. How many artists and scientists ought there to be among those vast legions and among their threatened children? There is a genius for impoverishment always at work in the world, and it has its way as if its proceedings were not only necessary, but even sensible. Its rationale, its battle cry, is competition. A great irony is at work in our historical moment. We are being encouraged to abandon our most distinctive heritage in the name of self-preservation. The logic seems to go like this. To be as strong as we need to be, we must have a highly efficient economy. Society must be disciplined, stripped down, to achieve this efficiency and to make us all better foot soldiers. The alternative is decadence, the eclipse of our civilization by one with more fire in its belly. We are prepared to think very badly of our antagonist, whichever one seems to loom at a given moment, and at the same time to emulate him. It is a convention of modern literature and of the going on of talking heads and public intellectuals to project what are said to be emerging trends into a future in which cultural, intellectual, moral, and economic decline will have hit bottom, more or less. Somehow this kind of talk always seems brave and deep. The specifics concerning this abysmal future are vague. Britain will cease to be Britain, America will cease to be America, France will cease to be France, and so on, depending which country happens to be the focus of Spenglerian gloom. The oldest literature of radical pessimism can again be read as prophecy. Of course, these three societies have changed profoundly in the last 100 years, the last 50 years, and few with any knowledge of history would admit to regretting the change. What is being invoked is not the actual past, but a notion of a precious and unnameable essence, second nature to some, in the marrow of their bones, in effect. By this view, others, whether they will or no, cannot understand or value it, and therefore they are a threat. The definitions of some and others are unclear and shifting. In America, since we are an immigrant country, our nativists may be first or second generation Americans whose parents or grandparents were themselves considered suspect on these same grounds. It is almost as interesting as it is disheartening to learn that nativist rhetoric can have impact in a country where precious few can claim to be native in any ordinary sense. Our great experiment has yielded some valuable results. Here a striking demonstration of the emptiness of such rhetoric, which is nevertheless loudly persistent in certain quarters in America, and which obviously continues to be influential in Britain and Europe. Nativism is always aligned with an impulse or strategy to shape the culture with it, which it claims to have this privileged intimacy. It is urgently intent on identifying enemies and confronting them, and it is hostile to the point of loathing toward aspects of the society that are taken to show their influence. In other words, these lovers of country, these patriots, are wildly unhappy with the country they claim to love, and are bent on remaking it to suit their own preferences, which they feel no need to justify or even fully articulate. Neither do they feel any need to answer the objections of those who see their shaping and their disciplining as mutilation. What is at stake now in this rather inchoate cluster of anxieties that animate so many of us is the body of learning and thought we call the humanities. Their transformative emergence has historically specificable origins in the English and European Renaissance, greatly expedited by the emergence of the printing press. At the time and for centuries afterward, it amounted to very much more than the spread of knowledge, because it was understood as a powerful testimony to human capacities, human grandeur, the divine in the human. And it had the effect of awakening human capacities that would not otherwise have been imagined. Alexis de Tocqueville, an early and classic interpreter of American civilization, published his Great Democracy in America in two volumes in 1835 and 1840. He was interested in the new society for its implications for civilization in Europe, especially France. His treatment of it is equable and perceptive, though he does have his doubts. Speaking in his introduction of the effects of the spread of learning in the countries of the West, he says, "From the moment when the exercise of intelligence had become a source of strength and wealth, each step in the development of science, each new area of knowledge, each fresh idea had to be viewed as a seed of power placed within people's grasp. Poetry, eloquence, memory, the beauty of wit, the fires of imagination, the depth of thought, all these gifts which heaven shares out by chance turn to the advantage of democracy, and even when they belong to the enemies of democracy, they still promoted its cause by highlighting the natural grandeur of man. Its victories spread, therefore, alongside those of civilization and education. Literature was an arsenal open to all, where the weak and the poor could always find arms. End of quote. This passage provides a sense of what became newly available to respect and admiration as knowledge spread through the populace. Poetry, eloquence, wit, imagination, depth of thought, where they would not have been seen or acknowledged in earlier generations. The old humanist joy in what people are still abides in Tocqueville, and he draws a humanist conclusion about the brilliance of people simply as such. Old Walt Whitman wrote, "I celebrate myself and sing myself, and what I assume you shall assume, for every atom belonging to me as good belongs to you." Any excellence, while it is given by heaven, more or less at random from the world's perspective, is testimony to the fact that human beings are endowed with the capacity for excellence, whatever form it takes in any individual case. Their natural grandeur, then overturning the old order, is not a matter of political or economic power, which, according to Tocqueville, are a consequence of the emergence of these gifts and secondary to them. The splendor of the gifts themselves, as they are liberated by new areas of knowledge, by fresh idea, makes the case for democracy. It is to be noted that these gifts are highly individual. There is no talk here of the folk or the masses, though the transformation of society Tocqueville describes has potential for radical progressive revolution. There is no suggestion that those who are rising can or should be shaped or led toward participation in a benign new order foreseen either by them or for them. The social order is forming itself around change brought about by these individual expressions of a collective grandeur. Tocqueville sees something like inspiration sweeping through the West as knowledge spreads and science advances. Crucially, there is no mention of competition, no implication of a hierarchy of abilities or gifts. Every excellence, every achievement enhances the general wealth of possibility for yet more excellence. And it is interesting to note that for Tocqueville, there is no simple notion of utility. This awakening of minds and spirits is a sunlight that falls across the whole landscape of civilization. The question being put to us now, what good are the humanities? Why are they at the center of our education? Might, for all history can tell us, be answered decisively by this vision of the effects of learning, which did take hold and flourish as the study of ancient poetry, philosophy, and language, scripture and theology, and of history itself, by means of the printing press and the rise of vernacular languages, long before science and technology even began to come abreast of them. Is Tocqueville describing something real? He stood at a place in the evolution of culture where there would be both a continuously new, because incremental, expansion of literacy and learning, and a vast population they had not yet touched. John Keats, briefly Tocqueville's contemporary, was moved by an Elizabethan translation of Homer. "Then felt I like some watcher of the skies when a new planet swims into his ken." What was it that Keats took from this encounter? What wild surmise? Keats holds such a rarefied place in literature now that it is hard to believe he was once ridiculed as one of the Cockney school of poetry. But his sonnet is expressing that old humanist privilege of being ravished by a book and of finding that it has a suggestive power far beyond its subject, a potency the affected mind itself might be years in realizing. I talked once with a cab driver who had spent many years in prison. He said he had no idea that the world was something he could be interested in, and then he read a book. In the history of the West, for all its achievements, there is also a persisting impatience with the energy and originality of the mind. The mind can make us very poor servants of purposes that are not our own. A Benthamite panopticon, his design for the perfect factory, would have radically reduced the varieties of experience that help to individuate us, in theory producing happiness in factory workers by preventing their having even a glimpse of the fact that there could be more to life. Censorship, lists of prohibited books, restrictions on travel, limits on rights of assembly, all accomplished by more practicable means, some part of the same exclusions, precluding the stimulus of new thought, new things to wonder about. The contemporary assault on the humanities has something of the same objective and would employ similar methods. Workers, a category that seems to subsume us all except the idlest rich, should learn what they need to learn to be competitive in the new economy. All the rest is waste and distraction, so we are told. Competitive with whom? On what terms? To what end? With anyone whose vigor and good fortune allows him to prosper, apparently. With anyone who has done a clever thing we did not think of first. And will these competitors of ours be left to enjoy the miserable advantage of low wages and compromised health? And is there any particular reason to debase human life in order to produce more, faster, without reference to the worth of the product or to the value of the things sacrificed to its manufacture? Wouldn't most people, given an hour or two to reflect, consider this an intolerably trivial use to be put to for them and their children? Life is brief and fragile, after all. Then what is this new economy whose demands we must always be ready to fill? We may assume it will be driven by innovation and by what are called market forces, which can be fads or speculation or chicanery. Oh yes, rowdy old capitalism, let it ply its music. Then again, in the all-consuming form proposed for it now, it is a little like those wars I mentioned earlier. It is equally inimical to poetry, eloquence, memory, the beauty of wit, the fires of imagination, the depth of thought. It is equally disinclined to reward gifts that cannot be turned to its uses. The urgency of war or crisis has been brought to bear on our civil institutions, which is to say, on the reserves and resources of civility we have created over many generations. We in America are famous for our endless and costly election seasons. I think they are a good thing, all in all, even though, as an Iowan, I am subjected to the campaigning longer than most of my countrymen. There is a logic in exposing candidates to grueling scrutiny for months at a time. Once one of them is elected, he or she will have greater control over how the public perceives them. But in the adversarial environment of primaries and elections, things are revealed that are highly germane to the question of a candidate's suitability for the presidency, which is certainly the most intense and pressured office in the world. Many of the candidates make themselves ridiculous, providing valuable information to the electorate. The parties grope to discover what is possible, what is needed or desired, or notoriously, they offer themselves as agents of certain interests of friendly billionaires, which we are led to believe align themselves nicely with the public interest. None of this is truer for the fact that it plays out in the press. We have no corner on foolish or mercenary politicians. But we do give ourselves a good long look at them when weeding takes place. It is regrettable that all the expense in time and money does not buy a more substantive national conversation. Still, we find out what notions and attitudes are lurking in the minds of some of our politicians and what they hope will have the power to stir some part of the populace. One of our candidates has called for an attack on the university cartel, by which he means our system of public higher education. The phrase is startling, considering that these institutions are, in effect, great city-states, shaped by their regions and histories, largely supported by their alumni, variously specialized around faculties that are attracted by distinctive areas of excellence. Recently, despite their enormous contributions to science and technology, they have been losing the support of many state legislatures, first on the pretext of austerity, and then on the grounds that they were properly understood as burdens on the public rather than as public assets. As state financing fell, tuitions rose, involving many students in burdensome debt. For generations, people had, in effect, prepaid their children's and grandchildren's tuition and underwritten the quality of their education by paying taxes. Suddenly, the legislatures decided to put the money to other uses or to cut taxes, and families were obliged to absorb much higher costs. For this, blame has fallen on the universities. And since the new cost of university is weighed against potential earnings, students and families being so burdened, the humanities are under great pressure to justify their existence. As it happens, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology has a fine music school and a creative writing program. And Rensselaer Polytechnic gives its students prizes for fiction and poetry. These schools might know something about nurturing the technical mind. But there is an impulse behind the recent assaults on great institutions that is historically expressed as social engineering. The ideal worker will not have a head full of poetry, say the neo-Benthamites. It is assumed, of course, that he or she will be potentially omnicompetent in service to the ever-changing needs and demands of the new economy, highly trained, that is, to acquire some undescribed skill set that will be proof against obsolescence. We await particulars. But the object is clear: to create a virtual army out of the general population who will compete successfully against whomever for whatever into an endless future at profound cost to themselves. All this differs from military engagement in one great particular. The generals are always assumed to be free to abandon their armies and go over to the other side if there is profit in it. The United States is in many ways a grand experiment. Let us take my own state, Iowa, as an example. What would early 19th century settlers on the open prairie do first? Well, one of the first things they did was found a university, which is now about 170 years old. Agriculture became, as it remains, the basis of the state economy. How did the university develop in response to this small agrarian population? It became, as it remains, a thriving and innovative center for the arts: theater, music, painting, and of course, creative writing. The medical school and the professional schools are fine as well. The sciences are very strong. But the arts are the signature of the place and have been for many generations. Let us say that these old Iowans did not invest their resources and their youth as wisely as they might have. Or let us say the world lying open to them, they had the profound satisfaction of doing what they wanted to do, at cost to themselves in mercenary terms, with immeasurable returns in humanist terms. Their university has been a great nurturer of American letters. If Tocqueville was right, it has nurtured a great deal more beside. What are we doing here, we professors of English? Our project is often dismissed as elitist. That word has a new and novel sting in American politics. This is odd in a period uncharacteristically dominated by political dynasties. Apparently, the slur doesn't stick to those who show no sign of education or sophistication, no matter what their pedigree. Be that as it may, There is a fundamental slovenliness in much public discourse that can graft heterogeneous things together around a single word. There is justified alarm about the bizarre concentrations of wealth that have occurred globally, and the tiny fraction of the wealthiest 1% who have wildly disproportionate influence over the lives of the rest of us. They are called the elite, and so are those of us who encourage the kind of thinking that probably does make certain of the young less than ideal recruits to their armies of the employed. If there is a point where the two meanings overlap, it would be in the fact that the teaching we do is what in America we have always called liberal education, education appropriate to free people, very much including those old Iowans who left their 4 years of university to return to the hamlet or the farm. Now, in a country richer than any they could have imagined, we are endlessly told we must cede that humane freedom to a very uncertain promise of employability. It seems most unlikely that any oligarch foresees this choice as being forced on his or her own children. I note here that these criticisms and pressures are not brought to bear on our private universities, though most or all of them receive government money. Elitism, in its classic sense, is not being attacked, but asserted and defended. If I seem to have conceded an important point in saying that the humanities do not prepare ideal helots or serfs, economically speaking, I do not at all mean to imply that they are less than ideal for preparing capable citizens, imaginative and innovative contributors to a full and generous and largely unmonetizable national life. America has known long enough how to be a prosperous country, for all its deviations from the narrow path of economic rationalism. Empirically speaking, these errancies are highly compatible with our flourishing economically, if they are not a cause of it, which is more than we can know. The politicians who attack public higher education as too expensive have made it so for electoral or ideological reasons and could undo the harm with the stroke of a pen. They have created the crisis to which they hope to bring their draconian solutions. Neo-Benthamism stands or falls with our unquestioning subservience to the notion of competition, which really comes down to dealing with the constant threat on the part of these generals to abandon their armies, and of course, with their demonstrated willingness to act on the threat. Does anyone who cares for such things owe them those great and ancient pleasures of life? Poetry, eloquence, the fires of imagination, the depth of thought. Are the pressures created in the larger world depriving us and the world of gifts the Chinese or the Russians would bring to it? We know these cultures have been rich and brilliant in ways that are no longer visible to us, at least. If we do have this effect, is there one good thing about it for us or for them? If the vastness of the Russian imagination, the elegance of the Chinese eye and hand, were present to us to admire without invidious comparison of them to us or us to them, wouldn't the world be richer for us all? If the rise of humanism was a sunrise, then in the present time we are seeing an eclipse. I take it to be a merely transient gloom, because the work of those old scholars and translators and printers, the poets and philosophers they recovered, and the poets and philosophers who came after them, the habit of literacy and the profound interest in the actual world and the present time have all taken hold more profoundly than we know. We have not lost them. We have only forgotten what they mean. We have forgotten to understand them for what they are. A spectacular demonstration of the capacities of the human mind, always renewed in our own experience, igniting possibilities no one could have foreseen. Tocqueville may be no more than conventional in speaking of them as, quote, gifts which heaven shares out by chance. And it may be that the convention of ascribing our gifts to a divine source, a convention which comes down from the earliest humanists, gave him and them a language able to capture something our truncated philosophies cannot accommodate. I never hear the phrase human grandeur, though many a planet has swum into my ken. Pluto did just the other day. I know the rings of Saturn in some detail. Step back and consider that more or less hidden from sight. Uniquely on this tiny planet, there was a cache of old books and scrolls, testimonies to human thought that, when opened, opened the universe to us. 600 years on, of course, which is not a heartbeat in cosmic time. An amazing tale, certainly. We deal in disparagement and feel it proves we are freer of illusion than earlier generations were. Tocqueville had seen the French Revolution, the Napoleonic Wars, but what of that? We are, as we have always been, dangerous creatures, the enemies of our own happiness. But the only help we have ever found for this, the only amelioration, is in mutual reverence. God's grace comes to us unmerited, the theologians say, but the grace we could extend to one another, we consider it best to withhold in very many cases, presumptively or in the absence of what we consider to be true or sufficient merit, we being more particular than God. Or because few gracious acts, if they really deserve the name, would stand up to cost-benefit analysis. This is not the consequence of a new atheism or of a systemic materialism that afflicts our age more than others. It is good old human meanness, which finds its terms and pretexts in every age. The best argument against human grandeur is the meagerness of our response to it, paradoxically enough. Then how to recover the animating spirit of humanism? For one thing, it would help if we reclaimed or simply borrowed conceptual language that would allow us to acknowledge that some things are so brilliant they can only be understood as virtuosic acts of mind, thought in the pure enjoyment of itself, whether in making a poem or a scientific discovery or just learning something it feels unaccountably good to know. There is an unworldliness in the experience and in what it yields that requires a larger understanding than our terse vocabularies of behavior and reward can capture. I've had students tell me that they had never heard the word beautiful applied to a piece of prose until they came to us at the workshop. Literature had been a kind of data to illustrate supposedly some graceless theory that stood apart from it and that would be shed in a year or two and replaced by something post or something neo, and in any case as gracelessly irrelevant to a work of language as whatever it displaced. I think this phenomenon is an effect of the utilitarian hostility to the humanities and to art, an attempt to repackage them to give them some appearance of respectability. And yet the beautiful persists, and so do eloquence and depth of thought, and they belong to all of us because they are the most pregnant evidence we can have of what is possible in us all. We humanists can teach with the confidence that in the treasury of which we are the present custodians, there is value that has been proved and will realize itself again and again in single minds and in the general mind. What we offer our students has something of the character of sacred fire. It throws off sparks that are much more than gleams of its own brilliance. Nature, as we experience it, is predictable, wholly obedient to its own laws. But by the grace of God, a most liberating phrase, we are free to be creators of the true and the possible, as those old humanists and all their successors have been for us. This is a delicate, reflective freedom, alive at every point, because at every point we are touching human thoughts, human senses. My favorite theologian calls the consciousness of this freedom a tenderness toward human circumstance, which, quote, and tenderness is a quote, which, quote, captures the tenuous, transitory quality of life, and the way we all seem to grope through the fog, trying to shape meaning, trying to be right, and why we need God's grace. End of quote. These are the words of Barack Obama, who is also, by God's grace, President of the United States. Learning, human grandeur, and democracy are linked, as Tocqueville says, always threatened and always ready to be discovered again. We teachers of the humanities have a sacred charge, and we should never let ourselves be persuaded otherwise. Thank you.
Dr. Robinson, many thanks for that wonderful, beautiful lecture. We've got about 10 minutes for questions, if that's all right with you.
I love questions.
You provided an eloquent, wonderful answer to the question of your title, but I'm sure there are still questions to be asked. ladies and gentlemen, there are a few microphones kind of attached to the front row. We'll try and use those if we can, but anybody got a question they might like to ask Dr. Robinson? A little hand, is that a hand at the back? Just combing your hair.
If you ask me a question, you'll make me very happy.
It's always the way, isn't it? It's always the first to quote. Any questions? There's a question at the back. There's a microphone there. Can we use that?
Thank you so much for your talk. I really like to hear about an affirmation of humanism and humanity. And in my discipline, in philosophy, much contemporary philosophy is about kind of the post-human and overcoming the human, which I can understand the critiques arriving at such a position, but because there's this idea there's no such thing as a universal humanity, I'm just wondering whether you've had any thoughts about going beyond the human and what might be the dangers of such a step?
Well, one hears this conversation, you know. I've been corrected in public for acting as if other kinds of creation were inferior to human beings and so on. I really am afraid of the consequences of undervaluing human beings. When I start teaching my classes, inevitably, it's probably a joke in my department, but inevitably I begin by saying a human brain is the most complex object known to exist in the universe. Just a human brain. This room is full of the most complex objects known to exist in the universe, you know? There is something impressive about that, I think, you know? One of the things that is an implication of it, as far as I'm concerned, is we haven't even begun to find out what we're capable of, or, you know, what anyone we encounter is capable of. They're in the sort of moralistic, let's stop talking about human beings or humanism or whatever. I think there is a curtailing of the sense of the extraordinary quality of human life, you know, of the sort of presumptive reverence that one owes to the presence of another person, you know. And of course this is completely consistent with my religious tradition, which I'm perfectly happy, you know, I mean, I'm happy when I see them coincide. I think it's absolutely true at the same time. We don't know what another human being is, and typically he or she doesn't know. You find out you have resources and brilliances and so on, anybody does. Then nobody can anticipate from the outside, that you can't participate until the moment comes when you are able to call on it, you know? I mean, it's all a great mystery. It's a mystery of continuous unfolding, how we live in time. But what we're always doing is finding ourselves over again, unless we are talked out of optimistic respect for what we are, you know? That's how I feel. The idea of undervaluing human beings in any degree, approaching them with less than awe, I think is dangerous.
Any other questions, anybody? Alice. Have my one.
Thank you so much for such a wonderful talk. It's really just full of tenderness and insight. So most of us probably know you best, obviously, as a novelist, and I wondered if you might talk a little bit about how the project of fiction, or even specifically of the novel, fits into this bigger project of the humanities.
I feel that I'm in conversation with literature that's gone before me. I feel that I'm in conversation really with streams of my own civilization as I understand them, you know. There's a way in which I tend to think of fiction, since I write both, I think of fiction as having dimensionality. You don't make a simple statement, you rotate an idea, you know, and look at it from various sides. But I never want to write essayistic fiction, but at the same time, I never feel as if my fiction and my essays are separate projects, you know.
Again, you can have my microphone.
Hello. Last month, President Obama actually quoted you as a eulogy in South Carolina. Do you feel as a writer, given that you feel in some quarters humanities are under threat, that your work is helping to fight the good fight for literature?
There are very few things in my life that have been as moving to me as the fact that Barack Obama likes my writing. I mean, that's really very gratifying. That I did not know he was going to do that. I didn't know he had done it until I got emails from people, as you can imagine. You know, one of the things that's very impressive about him is that he does not by any means have a one-track mind. You know, I mean, he understands economics. He talks with the people about how to get to Mars, all this sort of thing, at the same time that he is very deeply read in fiction. The poet John Ashbery, who's very well known and very revered in the United States, was asked by the New York Times what poetry he felt that Obama should read. And Ashbery said he'd spoken with him and was incredibly impressed with his knowledge of contemporary poetry, and that Obama knows perfectly well what book he should read, you know. He's a very atypical politician insofar as I have had any encounter with those people. And I think, I mean, he's an argument for the liberal arts in the sense that he understands a great many things, but he's not frozen into one way of understanding, you know.
I'm a great fan of your writing, and I've recently read your Lila, and I couldn't hear everything you said tonight. My hearing's not good, but everything I heard seemed to fit in with my feeling that Lila, the character Lila, is a most wonderful human being, and totally free in a very complex, in a complex life. And the whole book, I'm a Catholic priest, and I often have to preach, and I feel myself that what I'm saying is Lila.
That's wonderful. Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I hope I could be heard. Could I be heard in general? That's a problem I have sometimes, frankly.
Time for maybe just one more question? Anybody? So, do you need the microphone?
Phrase ravaged by something. Ravished or transported?
They
ravished
like the word.
Aggressive.
Well, you know, they like the word ravished. I mean, there I'm often reading people that have been translated from French, you know, who would have been using exactly that vocabulary. The emotional intensity, I mean, it's like they're just knocked over by this, you know, by Plato and so on, you know. How amazing it must have been to come to those things as relatively new, you know. So that was the, you know, I mean, perhaps in a modern vocabulary they'd have chosen another word, but that is their word.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome. Pleasure.
As Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Humanities, and on behalf of the university, I have the great pleasure to thank Professor Marilynne Robinson for her distinguished lecture tonight. I think she has given us a provocative title, What Are We Doing Here?, and caused us to think. It's been a fascinating insight in many ways into the underpinning philosophy and ideas, and indeed sentiments that really underpin her works of both fiction and indeed non-fiction. And I think it's quite interesting for us to reflect on those sort of larger questions we face in our lived lives and in our common existence. So thank you very much for that. Certainly as we live and breathe in arts and humanities, I think many of the themes you talked about tonight very much resonate with issues we face as academics in a UK context. So I think we understand exactly what you're saying. And for us, arts and humanities remains pivotal to understanding ourselves, our existence as people. We look forward very much to tomorrow. We look very much forward to bestowing upon you an honorary doctorate for your, certainly your most distinguished of writers. You're very worthy of this honor, and we thank you tonight for your contribution to our university. Thank you very much. And may I thank you all for coming tonight to the first Hopkins lecture and to our Department of English here. Thank you very much.